Hello and thanks for checking out this recording, Implementing DPI SSL Best Practices for Successful Deployment. My name is Jeremiah Johnson. I've been with Certint for going on 12 years. My day-to-day focus is with deployments and new technologies. With that said, let's go ahead and get started. Today, with the growing use of SSL on the internet, I want to discuss the need for SSL decryption and inspection, and then some key points for a successful deployment. To ensure that we're all on the same page, let's quickly review the basics of packet inspection as it's evolved over time. First, we had stateful packet inspection, very limited visibility into packets, sort of like a traffic cop deciding on who to let through based on the color, the type, and the direction of the car. But we didn't know what was in the car. Then we have DPI, which is just deep packet inspection. Now, we have more visibility into the packet as long as the doors aren't locked. If the packet is encrypted, we don't have the ability to read inside that packet. Now we have deep packet inspection for secure socket layer. It's sort of like X-ray vision into packets, allowing you to see through the encrypted data, apply your filtering to it, and make decisions on what's in that traffic without allowing seemingly good data into your network. And as I mentioned, the SSL continues to grow every year, and we really need visibility into this type of traffic. Most products, unfortunately, aren't able to, quote, see what's in the encrypted traffic, so it pretty much renders all the scanning technology that's in the current boxes useless. And based on the 2018 SonicWall's threat report, 68% of all web traffic is encrypted. That's up 6% from the 2017 report. And all this data is collected from the prior year. So it's based on 2018 is based on 17 and so forth. Malware attacks have risen from 7.87 billion to 9.32 billion. That's a big uptick in malware attacks. Ransomware attempts. This I find fairly interesting. So the attempts have actually dropped, but the variants have increased over 100%. So that means there's over 100% of new ransomware types out there. And although it sounds good that the attempts have dropped, they're becoming more sophisticated, if you will, in their targeting. And since ransomware is typically delivered via SSL, and most of the time that's not being inspected, it's kind of considered a trusted backdoor into your network. Now, if you would give me just a moment, I'd like to show you the new SonicWall Security Center. Okay, so here's the Security Center. What I really want to focus on is this middle tab here. And if we look, we can see that currently, as of the most recent data that's been pulled in, 93% of the traffic flowing through SonicWalls is encrypted. And if we look at the one right below this is what I was really focusing on. 679, there's an uptick of 679% for malware using SSL. So again, those numbers are very concerning if you're not using a device that can scan the encrypted traffic. And we'll switch back over here to the PowerPoint real quick. Okay, so let's take a quick look at the real cost of what ransomware can do to a company. 61% of organizations have been infected by ransomware. So if we do the easy math on that, we just say out of 100, that would be 61 organizations that have been infected. That's a large number if we stop and really think about that. 22% of businesses with under 1,000 employees stop business operations immediately because of ransomware. 1 in 6 organizations experience 25 or more hours of downtime. I'm not sure about your company, but I can tell you here at Certint, 25 or more hours, 3 hours, 2 hours would be very noticeable to our customers. We can't afford that, and I doubt you can either. Here's the bummer. Less than 50% of organizations that paid the ransom got their money back. So that's an even worse day. So you get infected with ransomware, you didn't have the proper equipment and software and hardware in place. You're already kicking yourself for that. You make the decision to pay the ransom, and they don't give you the key. So you don't get your data back still. Now, 60% of the small businesses that suffered the cyber attack were out of operation in 6 months. So again, the math is simple. That's 60 out of 100 companies. 31% of consumers impacted by a breach stated that they discontinued their relationship with that organization, and 65% lost trust in the organization. I think we've all probably been part of something or are familiar with something in the healthcare industry, Target, I'm sure your credit card or something, and you really question the company at that point in time and what they're doing to protect your data, right? Let's look at what SonicWall scans. SonicWall does HTTPS, FTPS, LDAP secure, SMTP secure, POP secure, IMAP secure, NNTPS, Telnet secure, and for all you 90s hackers out there, IRC secure. And please keep in mind that we're talking about protocols, not ports. So I recently had a customer that was a little confused on having port 443 traffic inspected, but not 8443. Well, they had changed their one of the websites they were going to had a colon 8443 at the end of it, and they were afraid that that wasn't being scanned, when in fact it is, because it's again the protocol, not the port we're talking about. So without getting into a technical deep dive, let's take a look at the way DPSSL works. The encrypted traffic passes through the firewall. Traffic is decrypted and scanned against SonicWall's gateway antivirus, intrusion prevention, gateway anti-spyware, content filtering, app control, and capture ATP. It's then re-encrypted and sent on to its destination. And this all happens by the concept called man in the middle. It's where, in our case, the SonicWall secretly relays the communication between two parties, the client and the server, who believe that they are directly communicating with each other, because we're using the SonicWall DPSSL certificate that allows us, as a trusted certificate, to interject that traffic. While talking about DPSSL, we have to briefly discuss SonicWall's Capture ATP. It's a complementary and it's really a much-needed feature for true zero-day threat protection. Capture ATP is a cloud-based offering for Gen 6 SonicWalls or newer. Capture utilizes technologies from VMray and Lastline to build a virtualized sandbox, hypervisor-level analysis, and full system emulation. It supports broad file types, executables, Office, PDFs, archives, JAR, and APK files, and also multiple OSs. Files that are not known and do not have an existing hash can be blocked until the capture cloud has determined if the file is good or malicious. And it only works for GUI-based applications, like you're downloading a PDF from a website, so to speak, or something along those lines. Things in the background obviously can be blocked until there's a verdict reached, but the user won't be notified of that. It would be something caught in the logs. If the file is identified as malicious, a signature is immediately available to firewalls with capture subscriptions to prevent any additional attacks. Standard security service subscribers usually receive the signature update within 48 hours, so it does pay to utilize Capture and contribute to the community. And Capture does have its own set of reports and alerts, so you do have the ability to set up alerts. If you choose not to block until verdict, you would still get an alert. It just would say, hey, this IP downloaded this file and you you should go check it because we ran it through our sandbox and it does look very malicious. So we covered what capture is. Let's look at a way that that file would throw through the Sonic wall. First, traffic enters the Sonic wall, and if you have DPI SSL in production, which I'm confident that you will by that point, it's decrypted. The packets are scanned against existing security services. And up to this point, everything we've stopped has been known as bad or has been allowed as good. The files that are in the gray area, or unknown files, are then sent up to the capture cloud for analysis and judgment. Depending on your settings, that again is going to be where they either download the malicious file and then they alert you, or it's held at the gateway and either allowed or blocked at that point. And like all great rewards in life, a little work is required. Remember though, if you're a certain customer or a potential certain customer, you do have a buddy in the process. We have an extensive companion guide and along with 24/7 support to help you get this feature enabled properly. Two of the biggest challenges with DPSSL is certificate deployment and certificate pinning. Pinning is a little easier of a fix. It requires basically an exclusion of the common name. Right now, if you're not familiar with certificate pinning, I'd encourage you to check it out. Essentially, it's kind of like a PIN number for a website between the browser and the server. Sizing the firewall is very important to get the right hardware or ensure that your current hardware will run the feature. It is a little bit intensive as to what it's doing. Certain strongly suggests running DPSSL on Gen 6 or newer appliances. We got to keep in mind that the SSL sessions that are now being scanned. So let me switch over here to a browser and we'll take a look to get an idea of what some of the sessions look like. Okay, let's hit F12 if you're in Chrome or Firefox. You go to network. Let's just go to Google for this one. And then you can see Google loads up these SSL sites right here, right? So it's about, there's 14 total requests that were opened. CNN.com. And you can see that quite a few more requests get loaded. So all of these with the lock, these are SSL sessions that are passing through the firewall. So we have to keep that in mind when we're looking at DPSSL connections. And please remember that this lock is not the international symbol for trusted traffic. And we'll switch back over to the PowerPoint here. And throughput's another thing that we have to consider. If we take a look here at the chart below, we can see the two models, the NSA 26, 100 and 2650, Gen 6 and 6.5. And if you look at the column under 2600, you can see the numbers. The max DPSSL sessions are 1,000 on the 629 firmware and 12,000 on the 2650. SonicWall is very aware of the limitations on hardware and software and are taking massive strides in resolving that, as you can see. Now let's look at the certificate portion of the deployment. You need to know what systems you're applying it to. Is it going to be iOS, Windows, Android? Are we going to try to do Linux? We need to know the browsers. Firefox does not play well with the Microsoft certificate store. Chrome and Edge can easily have the certificate pushed out via group policy. Deploying the certificate on trusted devices, or are you going to attempt to do this on the BYOD network? I recently had a customer that said that it was going to be pushed out to BYOD. We helped create an internal web page, hosted the certificate download with a note that says if you want on the internet, you will download this certificate and install it. We typically suggest that you exclude BYOD. Depending on the approved browsers, using AD and group policy is going to be the easiest way to push out the DPSSL certificate. And if AD group policy is not an option, SonicWall has tested these third-party solutions, AirWatch, ClearPass, SecureW2, and as I mentioned, an internal landing page to assist with installing the certificate. At the end of the day, it's about certificate management. But does it work? So I've already deployed the certificate, and once again, that's something we'll get into at some point, a little more deep dive. But I want to take a moment and go through the SonicWall and show you how DPSSL does work. Here to view, let's take a look at content filtering and how it works with DPSSL. Here we're going to test a couple social networking sites. We go to stumbleupon.com, and it's okay if you have no idea what that is. I was struggling to find a HTTP social networking site that loaded HTTP before a redirect, and I happened to find this, but I have no worries. SonicWall does know what StumbleUpon is and does have it rated properly. And we check Twitter because it is primarily HTTPS. Both, as you can see, work. And then we will take a look at the SonicWall. And all we're going to do is we're going to go here, and we're simply going to turn on social networking. So the block is now turned on for social networking. We'll close this. Open Firefox back up. And we will try stumbleupon.com. And as you can see, the normal content filter catches it. HTTP, not encrypted. Then we try Twitter.com. Twitter.com loads perfectly fine. Now we're going to log back into the SonicWall. And we're going to switch over here. Since we've already blocked it under Content Filter, we'll go to the Decryption Services. And we're simply going to turn Content Filtering on. SSL is already enabled. Close that out. Open it back up. And we go to stumbleupon.com, and again, still block HTTP. We try Twitter, and as you can see, it's now blocked by the content filter and HTTPS. So we can see that SSL decryption, which is for SSL traffic, is able to block the website. And what's even easier to see is if we go ahead and check the certificate. So if we look, Twitter.com is issued by the SonicWall. That's because the SonicWall trusted certificate is installed in the browser. Now let's switch back over to the PowerPoint. And you don't have to take my word for it. You can take young Clint Eastwood's word. It does work. We have seen it work and seen how DPSSL can inspect SSL traffic. SonicWall Capture Client. So, I know what you're thinking. Jeremiah's just talking about DPSSL, now we're switching over to something else. I promise you it's related. It's the same reason I brought up Capture itself. It's a complementary feature and one that will help with a huge task that is one of the biggest challenges. Capture Client's a cloud-based license service. It's soon to be supported on Windows and OS X. And works with or without SonicWall in front of the device. So the SonicWall can enforce it, or you can install it without a SonicWall firewall. And the reason I say soon is because as of April 13th, this product is still in beta and is soon to be released for public consumption and purchase. The clients will perform next-gen AV or AI scanning, capture sandbox, and endpoint telemetry. And one of the greatest things about this, you get the next-gen AV, which is machine learning instead of signature base, and DPSSL management. So it's going to manage the certificates that you need to push out in order for DPSSL to work. So instead of worrying about pushing certificates, you install the software, which you gain the added benefit of AI scanning or machine learning, and you gain the certificate. So you can do DPSSL. You have next-gen AV on your endpoint. So your odds of surviving an attack now are drastically increased. And with that, if you do have any questions, I would encourage you to reach out to our sales team. If you're an existing customer, go ahead and reach out through mycertain.com or call our support line and we can get you taken care of. We're a Sonic Wall shop and we stand by the product, but no matter what you have, you really do need to have this functionality in your network. You can look at Cisco's threat report, Verizon's data breach report, and they're all going to say the same basic thing. Most of the traffic going through your firewall and your network is encrypted, and if you're not scanning it, you really don't stand a chance to combat against the ransomware or malware attacks that are being delivered via SSL. It's really, really important that you have a handle on what's going through your network. And with that, if you do have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. I'm on Twitter. I tweet about rally cars, Disney, and Sonic Wall. So if that interests you, feel free to follow me. And I will look forward to talking to you guys some other time. We'll catch you later. Thanks for watching.